Shalom. Today we'll tackle another subject in the never-ending verb structures video. By now you should be familiar with all the seven binyanim. We're going to be talking about geminate verbs. Geminate means that the last two letters of the verb root are the same, as in Gemini, like twins, right? This idea of reduplication, where something, either a letter or a phoneme, repeats, is very widespread through many languages, and if you're a linguistics nerd like me, there's an article in Wikipedia that gives lots of examples from across all the different languages where things are repeated. For example, even in English, we say ding-dong. That's considered to be a reduplication of a syllable. Reduplication is very prevalent in Hebrew. You know this word, probably lev, which means heart, but sometimes it's written as levav with two bets. A lot of times Israelis will repeat the same word rather than say very or continue. They'll say the same word twice. For example, slowly is la'at la'at. They say it twice. It makes it more slowly. So an example of a geminate verb in Hebrew is sovev, samech bet bet. And it means to go around or to surround. First, we're going to look at the pa'al binyan. So the pa'al binyan actually looks quite normal, as we would expect. Sovev, sovevet, sovevim, sovevot. We'll look at some examples from Scripture. From Genesis 2:11, talking about the rivers that come out of Gan Eden, we see Shem ha'echad Pishon. The name of one is Pishon. Hu ha'sovev. Et kol eretz ha-chavila. This is the one that surrounds, it goes all the way around the land of Chavila. From 2 Chronicles 4:3, Solomon is building the accoutrements of the temple. This is talking about the laver, the huge basin, which is sitting on the back of oxen. So we see Udemut Bakarim Tachat Lo, and the figure of the oxen underneath him, that is the sea. Saviv, saviv. You see there's a repetition there. It's around as an adverb. Sovivim oto. They are surrounding it. That is the laver. So these are participle, geminate, pa'al verbs. Where we run into some irregularity is in the past tense, in the perfect tense. You see, it's not savavti, savavti, it becomes saboti, sabota, sabot. And when you're looking at these, all of a sudden it looks like, wait, there's only two letters to the root, and maybe I'm looking at a hollow or something like that. So it is easy to confuse with the hollow verbs as you look at the different forms. What we see is that in the first and second person, singular and plural, it follows that form where it drops a second bet. In the third person, the singulars look kind of normal. The plural, we're going to see the plural masculine takes both forms, with the second bet and without. From Ecclesiastes 2:20, Solomon is speaking, Visaboti ani leyayesh et libi, and I turned to despair my heart. So we see this form with the one bet. In 1 Samuel 7:16, we see a third person singular masculine, and it looks like a normal form. V'halach midei shana b'shana, talking about Samuel. And he went around year by year, v'savav beit el, v'ha'gilgal, v'ha'mitzpah. And so he's like a circuit rider, and he's riding around year by year to these places, Bet-El and Gilgal and so on. He's riding around. Of course, we're going to see a lot of circling around in Joshua. So in Joshua 6:3, this first example, this is a second person, masculine plural. It has one bet. V'sabotem et ha'ir. And you will circle around the city. In Joshua 6:15, we see the a third person plural with both bets. Starting in the middle of the verse, Rak by Yom Hahu, that's talking about the seventh day, only on that day, Savavu et ha'ir sheva pa'amim. They went around the city seven times. Now, this example in Psalm 88:17 includes that third person masculine plural with the one bet, and it has a suffix on it that means me, something they did to me. And they surrounded me, sabuni kamayim, like water. As we go to the imperfect tense, we see that, again, it's a single bet. Not asovev, but esov, tisov, tisobi. In all these past and future forms, the prefixes and the suffixes which govern the person remain the same. It's just what happens to the root. So we'll look at some examples. In Numbers 36:7, this is talking about that each tribe should keep its inheritance and that it shouldn't go from one tribe to another. So it says, "Velo tisov nachala livnei Yisrael mimateh el mateh." Do not return, do not turn around the inheritance of the children of Israel from tribe to tribe. Again, in Joshua 6:4, we're seeing an imperfect tense for all y'all will be going around again. Uvayom hashvi'i tasobu et ha'ir sheva pa'amim. And on the seventh day, you will go around one bet, a city, seven times. And we know that they did, and we know that it worked. In Genesis 37:7, we see the feminine plural. This is from Joseph's dream, and he's telling about it. And he's talking about the sheaves of his brothers. And it says, Vehine tisubena alumotechem, v'tishtachavena la'alumati. So, behold, tisubena, they are surrounding, they are going around what? The sheaves. Whose sheaves? He's talking to his brothers, all y'all sheaves. So it's a feminine plural, alumot. They're surrounding and also bowing down to my sheaf. In a third person singular, speaking when Joseph is with his brothers, and before he has revealed himself, it says, Vayisov me'alehem vayefk, and he turned himself away from them, and he wept. Very touching scene. Again, from Joshua 6, a third person masculine plural, Vayasobu et ha'ir b'yom hesheni, and they went around the city on the second day. When we come to the geminate root in PL, it begins to look more normal as we would expect a PL to look, and we're going to look at some examples. I just wanted to mention that in some of the grammars that were established by the linguists maybe in the 17th or 18th century, maybe the 19th century, they began to invent some binyanim that matched what they were looking at. And so sometimes you will see a binyan poel. There's also one called polel, and there's something called palal and pilpel. There are things that they made to suit the paradigm of what they were looking at. These binyanim do not appear in Israeli grammars. In Israel, they don't talk about these kind of made-up binyanim. They do have actually some new ones, which is efal and shifal, to match new verb formations for words that are not in Tanakh. But this poel they don't have. So I just wrote it in English. If you look up a word, for example, on Blue Letter Bible, if you're looking at the Jacinius, for example, he will list some uses under each one of the binyanim, and you might see these odd ones that are not in the chart, and we haven't talked about them. So you see, this is the geminate in PL. It looks just like another PL. For example, if we have lidaber, to speak, the imperfect will be adaber, tidaber, tidabri. And here we have asovev, tisovev, tisovevi. It looks quite normal for a PL. All the letters of the root appear in all the tenses. Here are some examples. From Song of Songs, chapter 3, verse 2, Akuma na va'asaveva ba'ir bashvakim. I will get up And I will go around the city in the marketplaces. You know what a shuk is. The plural of shuk is shvakim. Both these verbs, akuma and asovava, have this hay on them. Now, this is another thing about in the Israeli grammar. This hay, whether it's on a noun or on a verb, is called hay hatenua, the hay of movement. And they do not distinguish in a name between a noun and a verb. In the classical grammars, the hay on the noun is the directional hay. We're going in that direction. Habaita, Yerushalayma, that's the direction we're going, and we get there. And for the verbs, they have three different adjectives that they use depending upon first, second, or third person, including jessive and cohortative and one other one, which I forget. The idea is, in any case, the idea is emphasis. But in Israeli grammar, they just say, hey, hatnua. They don't care if it's a noun or a verb. That's what that hey is doing there. From Jeremiah 31:22, here is a third person feminine singular. Probably you are familiar with this verse. From the middle of the verse, Ki bara Yehovah chadasha ba'aretz. Yehovah is creating a new thing in the earth. Nekeva tisovev gever. A woman will surround a man. Actually, there's almost no difference between the PL use of sovev and the pa'al use. They both mean to go around. From Psalm 59, verse 6, Yeshuvu la'erev yehemu ka'kalev visovevu ir. They return in the evening. They make a noise in their throat like a dog, a growling, and they surround the city. So this is a third-person masculine plural, yisovavu. I will put the link for the hollow verb conjugations for in PL and hitpael. What happens in the hollow verb is that the last letter doubles. So now they begin to look like geminates. So there's just a lot of opportunity to be confused between these things. The geminate in the pa'al and the hollow in the PL are going to begin to look like each other. I know it's confusing. I hope this is somehow helpful to you. I'm sure I'll find another topic to make a verb video on. In the meantime, Tasimita Einayim al Hashemayim, keep your eye on the sky. Your redemption draweth nigh. Shalom.